what I think is an exciting opportunity for W4UVA. My name is Mike McPherson, KQ9P. I'm also a trustee for W4UVA and have been looking for things that the students can get excited about. And my experience has been that most college-level students, when you say, hey, you can talk to people all around the world on ham radio, they say, yeah, do that. Tell me something I can't do already. Satellites, they can't do themselves, and in fact, are pretty excited about this. So, what are we doing? We are building not one, but two amateur radio satellite ground stations in support of a CubeSat project that's being done by University of Virginia, Virginia Tech, Old Dominion, and Hampton. They are building, I think I've got a slide here, yeah, a constellation of three satellites that will be launched simultaneously. I'll show you what they look like in just a minute. I'm not going to spend a huge amount of time talking about the satellites, but I do want to give you a little bit of background on CubeSats and on the UVA CubeSats in particular. So they're going to launch three CubeSats simultaneously in a single launcher, which is very cutely called a P-pod. So these three P's are going to pop out of the P-pod all at the same time. They will orbit together for most of their lifetime, which is anticipated to be something on the order of 3 months before they re-enter. The Old Dominion satellite at some point during the mission will deploy drag brakes and will drop itself to a lower orbit and move significantly ahead because it's in a lower orbit. It'll be going faster. So it'll move significantly ahead of the other two satellites for the final portion of the mission. But for most of the mission, they should be within a kilometer or so of each other. It's important because this is actually FunCube 1, but the three Virginia CubeSat Constellation satellites will look very, very much like that. One U satellite, which means one U in CubeSat terms is 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters. They can weigh, depending on who launches you, either a kilogram or about 1.2 kilograms, depending on the launch vehicle. And you actually get quite a lot of, you can cram quite a lot of goodies inside of a 10 centimeter cube, as it turns out. There's a lot of commercial stuff on the market for building CubeSats, several major sources for all of the components. And the UVA satellite will be built entirely from commercial off-the-shelf components to minimize the risk. This is UVA's first satellite. And rather than build a bunch of stuff from scratch and risk having it not work, they're going for things that have what's called flight heritage, things that have actually been into space and proven that they work in this kind of application. So you can cram quite a lot into that space. They get there through what's called the NASA CubeSat Launch Initiative. NASA every year gives grants to K-12 institutions mostly. And in fact, there has been one elementary school that designed and built and launched a CubeSat. And it worked too, which is really cool because a lot of the CubeSats fail. It's a high risk endeavor. But they're relatively cheap to build as satellites go. It costs about $60,000 to build a CubeSat, roughly. And so you're not losing a billion-dollar satellite if something goes wrong. You can afford to try new things and fail. But I think last year was a banner year. Let's see, do we say this is relatively old data from NASA. I think there were over 100 CubeSats launched last year, including one mission on an Indian launch vehicle that they put 70 satellites in orbit in one launch or something like that. It was an amazing operation. So this information is on NASA's website. I'm not going to read the whole slide to you. Go up on both commercial and government launch vehicles. Basically, every launch vehicle has one or more paying customers. The billion-dollar communications satellite, the spy satellite, the weather satellite, whatever. And they're paying for the launch. They're bearing the great majority of the cost of the launch. But there are nooks and crannies that don't have anything in them. And the launchers, the P-pod, and there's another launcher that's not called a Peapod, I can't remember what it's called, are designed to fit into the nooks and crannies on these launch vehicles. And so a lot of satellites get launched that way. The main satellite will take up the most of the space under the nose cone, and then there'll be two or three Peapods tucked in underneath the satellite inside the shroud, and after the main satellite, the paying satellite, has been launched and is well clear, the Peapods will open and pop out their CubeSats. A bunch of them also get into orbit via the space station. They go up as cargo on a space station resupply mission, and at some point the astronauts are scheduled to open a window and chuck the satellite up. You laughed. My wife didn't laugh. Excellent. She said I should say that she didn't laugh. I'm not sure she understood it's being recorded. So you can get that information on the website. This is a schematic of what the VCC mission is going to look like. Three satellites. Each of them will have a UHF radio. We're working in the 70 centimeter band in the satellite service allocation. So each will have a 70 centimeter radio for talking to the ground. And each one will also have a really spiffy little chip that's designed for the Internet of Things, which you've all read about and understand that you should be afraid of. But the Internet of Things is also driving a whole lot of R&D and really innovative stuff in radio, because these things that make up the Internet of Things have to get connected to the Internet somehow. And they're going to be very small portable devices, you know, stuff that one of these days this little remote control will be an Internet of Things device. And so it needs to have some sort of wireless connectivity that runs on very low power, because chances are be batteries. A lot of things are going to be a lot of sensors in the Internet of Things won't even have a battery. They'll run off solar power. They'll scavenge RF energy from RF in the environment. So there's a whole lot of really cool work being done on very small, very low power, cheap, like disposable cheap radios that are very capable. And this chip is one of them. The RFM69 it comes in two flavors. There's a 70 centimeter flavor and a 900 megahertz flavor. It's good for up to a couple of kilometers in real world conditions. Low power, unlicensed, data native. You know, it's not for voice or anything like that. It's a data radio. And it'll do over short range, over less than a kilometer, you can do 56 kilobits per second. Over a couple of kilometers, you can probably do 9600. So they're going to use those radios to chatter back and forth between the satellite. Question?
Are those the lower RFs?
Yeah, exactly. They're the very cleverly named LoRa, long range, is the standard, and there's a mesh network standard that's layered on top of LoRa. They're not going to use the mesh stuff for these. They're going to write their own code and communicate directly between the satellites. And you see down here, this is Virginia Tech ground station, Old Dominion ground station. If we already have two ground stations, why are we building another one? It's because we don't have one, and the University of Virginia has to have a ground station. And besides bragging rights, there are also some good reasons for it. I mentioned these satellites are going to be about a kilometer apart, which means they're going to be overhead at the same time. And the Virginia Tech ground station is going to be busy talking to the Virginia Tech satellite, likewise with the Old Dominion, so we can't rely on either of the other schools to talk to our satellite. We have to have our own ground station, and hence this project. Why two? The one that will almost certainly be on the roof of the mechanical engineering building is going to be the primary ground station, like the satellite, built from commercial off-the-shelf components, which I'll talk about in a minute, to minimize risk. Copying designs that are in production at a number of other universities, and will look familiar to people who have satellite ground stations in their backyard. And then the other one is going to be at the W4UVA station up the hill, 100 yards or so. It's going to be mostly homebrew, and it will be our experimental platform. It'll also serve as backup in case the primary fails. But and we'll be tracking our satellite with both stations, assuming both of them are working. But we'll feel much more free to tinker with antennas and software and such on the backup station, because it won't be bearing the burden of the work. Okay, so what goes into a satellite ground station? Basically, there are five things that a ground station has to be able to do. It has to be able to point the antennas at the satellite. Low Earth orbit satellites, and I'm going to talk about orbits in just a minute here, make their pass overhead in at most about 20 minutes, depending, and that's if they go directly overhead. The great majority of the passes are lower passes, and so they're above the horizon for much less than 20 minutes. You may get 10 minutes. So you've got to do some serious tracking. You're moving the antennas pretty fast. They have to be able to schedule activities and uplink commands, firmware updates, whatever, to the satellite when it's overhead. And because you have very little time, you can't spend a lot of time at a keyboard thinking about it. You have to schedule it ahead of time. You have to say, on pass number 12, we're going to do this. And it's all scheduled and automated. And when the satellite comes above the horizon and we link up with it, the computer starts sending commands to the satellite. We're not sitting there typing commands. We're sitting there watching things happen. You have to be able to downlink data. These satellites are going to generate a lot of data. They'll each have a GPS receiver on them, a very high precision space rated GPS receiver. That's a part of the experimental package. And so they're going to be taking a lot of very high resolution position and time data. And there'll also be a lot of satellite health and welfare kinds of telemetry that's being collected. Also, information about the communications between the three satellites. And this all has to come down in the worst case scenario when the satellite is over our ground stations. There's some tricks you can play that leverage the amateur radio community to create a much larger footprint for downlink, and we're going to do that as well. You have to be able to decode this data. It comes down digital. Satellite communications, CubeSat communications, the telemetry is all digital telemetry. So you have to decode it, distribute it to the parties who have a stake in the mission, and preserve it and make sure you don't lose it. And you have to log everything, because the science on this mission is all about where the satellites are in space. They're going to be interested not only in the students involved in the project will be interested not only in the telemetry from the satellite about position and time, they're also interested in what the ground stations think about where the satellites are. And so each of the ground stations has what's called a GPS disciplined oscillator on it, which is basically an extremely precise clock that's locked, whose precision and synchronization between the ground stations is created by GPS. Plus, we'll know a lot about the position of the ground station and which direction it's pointing. Michael?
Do the CubeSats have any ability to change their orientation?
Yes, they do. And in fact, the CubeSats on this mission will have that. Not all CubeSats do. There's a penalty in both weight and power for controlling your positioning. These satellites will each have what's called a magnetorquer, which is an active a device that generates a magnetic field. And that magnetic field will align with the Earth's magnetic field. And that will keep, so each of these satellites will, I know the Virginia Tech, or the UVA satellite and the Virginia Tech satellite are going to have two magnetorquers, which means they will be stabilized in two of the three axes. And so effectively, those two satellites will be pointed along the orbital path. they will almost certainly rotate about the direction of travel, but they won't tumble. And that happens fairly early after launch. The magnetorquers are turned on, and within 90 minutes or something like that, the satellite is stabilized in two dimensions. I think the ODU satellite has three magnetorquers, so they're actually going to try to stop it from spinning. They want their satellite to be stabilized, if I remember correctly. So, orbits. There are probably people here who know more about this than me, so please shout out if I get it wrong. There are five basic kinds of orbits for satellites. There are low Earth orbit satellites, which is what our satellite is going to be. Those are in orbits that are comparable to the space station. They are also orbits that decay, and so spacecraft that are in low Earth orbit that you want to stay there, you have to give a kick every once in a while. Otherwise, they fall out of orbit, because at those altitudes, you're still in the upper reaches of the Earth's atmosphere. There is drag. Then there's medium Earth orbit. This is satellites like the GPS constellation. The advantage of medium Earth orbit is that you don't have to give them a kick every once in a while to keep them up there. They're outside the atmosphere in an effectively drag-free environment. So they stay up there until you do something to bring them down or just abandon them. Of course, the downside is it takes a whole lot more energy to put a satellite in a medium Earth orbit than it does in a low Earth orbit. Then you've got what I always thought were synonyms, geostationary and geosynchronous. It turns out, I've learned just recently, they're not. Geosynchronous means that the orbital period of the satellite is equal to one Earth day. So the satellite goes around the Earth at the same rate that the Earth revolves. And so from the ground, the satellite appears to stay in the same place in the sky. Geostationary satellites do that over the equator. So that's the difference. A geostationary satellite is, by definition, over the equator, which limits its footprint in the northern and southern hemispheres. That's why most of the useful satellites, like the satellites that give you direct broadcast TV and that kind of stuff, are geosynchronous but not geostationary. They're at higher latitudes but remain over a fixed point in the sky. I didn't know that. And then there are some high Earth orbit that are actually beyond geostationary. I'm not sure what they are or what they're for. They're probably spy satellites or something like that. So in order to be able to predict where the satellite is going to be from the perspective of the ground station, you have to reduce all of this to a mathematical equation. And orbits are described by Kepler's laws of motion. And consequently, the orbital parameters are sometimes called Keplerian elements, or KEPS for short. The format that these take, orbital elements for amateur radio satellites, are most often what's called the two-line element, which very conveniently usually consists of three lines. There's almost always a satellite name as the first line. The second line is international identifier for the satellite, information about time as it relates to the satellite. That has to do with when the satellite was launched and when it achieved orbit and other things. Most of this stuff here is time related. And then the second business line that contains data, is the one that contains information about the inclination of the orbit from the equatorial plane, the position in the orbit at a particular time, all of the things that you need to compute where in space the satellite is. And once you know where it is in space, it's fairly easy to turn that into where it is from your perspective on the ground. And there's a lot of software, both commercial and open source, for doing these calculations. The one that a lot of university ground stations use is something called Predict. That's the Linux non-graphical interface version. There's a graphical version called gpredict that's available for both Linux and Windows and Mac. So if you're interested, you can download gpredict for whatever computer you've got, and you can see where satellites are. Those talk to positioners, and lots of you have a rotator on a beam on your house. These are just two rotators stuck together. One rotates around the vertical axis, one rotates around the horizontal axis. This is just an empty tube that goes through. You put a boom through it. And the one on the left is the extremely expensive commercial unit we're going to buy for the main antenna array. And the one on the right, actually, I was hoping Mark Whitus would be here tonight. He turned me on to, that's sitting on my workbench right now, is a pan-tilt unit from a commercial surveillance camera. Interestingly, this particular pan-tilt was available in a radiation-hardened version and was installed at SAC bases all over the country. Yeah. So the one that I have is not radiation hardened. So, you know, if we take a nuclear strike on our ground station, we're out of luck, I guess. But it actually does most of it. It'll tilt from one horizon all the way over to the other. So far more than we need. All we need to do is go from the horizon to straight up for satellite work, and it'll do about 350 degrees of azimuth, which is plenty good because where it's going to be located, part of the old reactor building is right in the way, and that section of the sky is useless, so I'll put the dead spot on the positioner pointing at the building. And I got that sucker on eBay for $35. This one's $4,000. So, question?
No.
Oh, I thought I saw your hand go. So you turn the position in the sky into azimuth this way, and elevation that way. And the computer updates that constantly as the satellite moves across the sky. Oh, well, you could probably figure it out if 20 minutes from horizon to horizon. So what's that turn out to be? So a direct overhead pass is going to be something like 20 minutes long. So so 180 degrees in 20 minutes, it's fairly quick. This thing's certainly capable of it. Both of those positioners are easily capable of that. Yeah?
What's the size of the cone of reception? How precise and accurate does your $35 device have to be?
Since the antennas on that are going to be fairly sloppy, the antennas will be homebrew, probably homebrew Yagis with 10 or 12 elements. So the beam width on those is going to be something like 30 degrees. So, it's government work. The big array will have a much tighter beam. That one is going to be stacked Yagis, and will have a beam width of more like 14 or 15 degrees. So, plus, as I mentioned earlier, a part of the data for the science in the project is the main part of the science project is where these satellites are in space, and so they're going to be interested in where the antennas were pointing. We thought the satellites were going to be here. Did we find them where we pointed the antenna? So actually, knowing more precisely which direction the antenna is pointed is going to be important for this particular project. For your typical amateur radio satellite, not so important. You get within a few degrees, you're going to be fine. That's why the so-called easy sats, the FM repeater satellites, amateur radio repeater satellites, you can work with a handheld Arrow or Elk or something like that. Those have a beam width of 40 degrees maybe, and as long as you get like within 10 or 15 degrees, you're going to be fine.
Dishes are too big.
Too big, too expensive. The Virginia Tech ground station does have a dish, however. They have two dishes, actually. But they have more money than they know what to do with down there. For anybody who pays attention to satellite stuff, slight digression, as long as you mentioned it, Joe. The satellite operation at Virginia Tech, which has been up and running for a number of decades, and they've built a number of satellites down there, not just CubeSats, but bigger satellites that have gone through traditional launch process. That whole operation is run by a gentleman by the name of Bob McGuire, who's a aerospace engineering prof at Virginia Tech and a ham, and has been deeply involved in AMSAT since almost the beginning. And so Bob is a master at raising money and buying stuff, and so their ground station is way, way beyond anything that we could possibly aspire to right now. But we are duplicating the 2-meter, 70-centimeter part of their ground station. Ours will be very similar to theirs, but we won't be able to yet do the higher band stuff that that they're capable of already. But, Bob McGuire's group is the group that is doing the design and engineering for the geosynchronous amateur radio satellite that they were going to launch next year, and that'll probably be 2019. And that's quite a project. If you haven't looked into that, there's a bunch of information on their website down at Tech, pointed to from the AMSAT website. It's quite an ambitious project. But that will, as opposed to most of the amateur radio satellites, which are whizzing overhead so quickly that, that they're really only of interest to hobbyists, the satellite that Bob and his group are working on will be parked over North America 24/7, and will actually be useful. And part of the plan is to use it for ARRIs and to have a bunch of satellite ground station go kits that can be checked out for disasters, to be able to use high bandwidth digital communications via satellite in disaster areas that have lost all of their terrestrial communications.
Is this thing to use for ARRIS contacts?
For ARRIS contacts?
Yeah.
For the space station?
Yeah.
Yeah, it certainly could be, and we probably will. I would like to. I think that's something that I'd love to see the W4UVA club get into, partner with local schools and get some ARRIS activity going here. ARRIS, for those of you who don't know, is amateur radio on the International Space Station. There is a ham radio station on the space station. And a bunch of the astronauts are hams, and they schedule contacts with schools, typically partnered with a local amateur radio club, to provide the equipment and the expertise, and the students get to talk to astronauts. So the amateur satellite service has allocations in most of the amateur radio bands, certainly at 10 meters and above. Most of the action is still on 2 meters and 70 centimeters, although there's a lot of pressure that's pushing that up in frequency. Terrible congestion on 2 meter. You can't get a downlink frequency on 2 meters anymore. They've stopped allocating those because it's just it's too congested. You can still get downlinks on 70 centimeters, but the day is coming when you won't be able to do that anymore, and you'll have to move up to a higher frequency band. So our ground stations will both be capable of taking antennas for higher frequency bands. And the good news is there's a lot of cool stuff going on with microwave integrated circuits that's making this much more possible and much cheaper. This is what the big antenna is going to look like. It's a couple of 12-element 70-centimeter dipole or Yagis stacked on top of each other, and these are crossed Yagis, so it's actually two Yagis on a boom at 90 degrees with phasing lines between the two Yagis, and the phasing lines allow you to switch. So when you cross two Yagis on the same boom, you get, instead of horizontal polarization, you get circular polarization. Satellites are all circularly polarized. No matter what the shape of the antenna on the satellite is, by the time the signal gets to the Earth, it's circular polarization. As it goes, if it starts off linear as it goes through the ionosphere, the ionosphere starts it rotating. And so you always use, if you want to get the best signal, you use circular polarization in the ground. You're never really sure whether it's going to be left-hand or right-hand, though, because that depends on the orientation of the satellite in space. And so what you want to be able to do is to switch back and forth. And so each of these four Yagis will be able to be switched back and forth between left-hand and right-hand circular polarization under computer control to get the best signal at any point in time. The reason we're stacking them is to squash the pattern in elevation. A big issue with satellites, these signals are very weak. The power budgets on these CubeSats are very, very tight. And so our radio, the UHF radio on the satellite will be transmitting tops 1 watt. Chances are it'll be more like a half a watt into a little dipole antenna. Not pointed at the Earth. So we're going to be straining our ears to hear our satellite. And most of the little CubeSats are like this. So we want the gain, but we also want to minimize the contribution from the ground, because the ground gives you a lot of noise. And so the reason for stacking them is to limit the pattern in the vertical direction. So when we're down low to the horizon, we're not getting nearly as much noise contribution from ground sources. We will be using software-defined radio. This is an Edis Research USRP N210, which is the latest and greatest from USRP. This is about a $3,500 radio. It does DC to 6 gigahertz. Native, and has two receive and two transmit chains, so we can actually listen and talk at the same time if we want to. Although our satellite will be half duplex, it'll be either listening or talking. So this is for future expansion. We're building some growth in here. Now. This is something I'd never done before. If you're a satellite hobbyist, you're probably never going to do this. You'll figure out where the satellite is. You'll point your antenna where you think the satellite is. And if you hear it, you celebrate. And if you don't hear it, you try again later. We can't do that. If I pointed the ground station at our satellite after it was launched and up in space and we couldn't hear it, I'd be run out of town on a rail, and my life would be worth nothing. So we do what's called a link budget. A link budget, quite literally, takes into account every single contribution to gain or loss anywhere in the path between the radio on the satellite and the radio on the ground. So it's antennas, it's transmission lines, it's filters, it's loss in connectors, loss in coaxial cable, loss in the atmosphere, loss due to digital encoding schemes. Each encoding scheme requires a certain amount of signal-to-noise ratio in order to function properly, and that gets factored in as so many dB of loss, and that changes depending on what encoding scheme you're talking about. Polarization. You have to factor in a certain loss for mismatch and polarization, and you end up with this Byzantine spreadsheet. And fortunately, the AMSAT people have constructed a link budget spreadsheet, which you can download from the AMSAT UK site, which is both a spreadsheet for doing your link budget, but it's also a lesson in how to do link budgets. It's a wonderful spreadsheet, full of comments. It's a teaching tool. I never would have been able to do it without this tool from AMSAT. And so you end up with, and what you want is for this box to be green. And that means the link is closed. Your link being closed is what you're shooting for. If your link is open, it means you're not communicating. And so my calculations show that on the uplink, That's the ground station sending stuff up to the satellite. We're going to have a very comfortable margin. We'll have about a 24.5 dB margin going up. Coming down, whoop, it's off the bottom. On the downlink, we're going to be pretty good. I think we're going to have about a 12 dB margin on the downlink. So we've got some wiggle room for something to go wrong. We could probably tolerate an antenna only partially deploying, something like that. Or satellite tumbling if the magnetorquers don't work right. You know, we can cope with some things that aren't optimal, which was part of the design goal, to have enough margin on the link that we can tolerate something going wrong, because things go wrong. Something like half of these CubeSats fail for one reason or another. They never power up. The ground station's never able to establish communications. They fail shortly after they achieve orbit. You know, they power up, you're talking to them, and then they die. Something goes wrong about half the time. And I wanted to make sure that if something went wrong, it wasn't my fault. Yeah, or at least they can't prove it's my fault. That's right. So from a software perspective, this is all done, as I said, under computer control. Most satellite work is done with something called GNU Radio. It's an open source programming environment for running software-defined radios and building radios in software. And so the whole thing will be done. For those of you who don't know what a software-defined radio is, it's basically an RF front end, a digitizer that digitizes the intermediate frequency, and a really, really fast special purpose computer that does everything else. The computer is the radio. And that's what that $3,500 USRP is. It's an RF front end. Very, very nice, very low noise RF front end. Very high speed digitizers. And a colossal, what's called a field programmable gate array, which is a computer that can be reprogrammed. The hardware can actually be reprogrammed to do whatever you want it to do. So it runs programs, but it runs programs in hardware instead of running them in software. You compile your program to a set of gates. And those, the instructions for creating those gates get downloaded to this chip that has, I think the one in this, in the N210, I think has 3 million gates or something like that. And so basically you're doing, it's like fabricating a chip, except you can do it over and over and over and over and over again. It's really cool technology, and it allows you to run software at hardware speeds, or very nearly hardware speeds. And then all of this, number five on my list was manage the data, schedule the communications with the satellite, distribute the data, archive the data. And just like everything else, we're trying not to do this from scratch. There are a couple of nascent open source ground station software projects that look really promising, and we're going to try to use one of those. There's one out of University of Hawaii. There's another one out of I just went blank, but we're looking at both of them. And the Virginia Tech stuff has some, the Virginia Tech folks have some stuff that's really good as well, and they've offered to let us run their software if we want. So we'll be using something that other people have already used for successful missions before, rather than rolling our own. And if you want to keep an eye on what's going on, I'm posting updates on the W4UVA website, w4uva.org. So, thank you. Any questions?
What is the time frame for this in terms of getting the satellites up, the CubeSats up going?
So, our three satellites are number 17 on the wait list, And based on past history, barring launch vehicles exploding on the launch pad and other such things, if we assume that everybody keeps launching at the rate that they've been launching, that means that we should get manifested for a launch next spring sometime, something like now, a year from now. These CubeSats typically have to be delivered to the launch company about 6 months before launch. And that would mean that our satellites have to be done in the fall. So hardware is being ordered right now. The components for the satellites, they'll be assembled and tested over the summer. The student teams will be taking their satellites out to NASA Wallops, which is the NASA site that is the liaison for the grant for this project. And so they'll be taking our three satellites out to Wallops and putting them on the shake table and shaking the daylights out of them to simulate a launch, see if they come apart. They've got a vacuum chamber where they can take it down to space level vacuum and cold soak the satellites and see if they turn on and see if the antennas pop out and all that sort of stuff. So they'll be doing that testing over the summer, and the idea is final testing and putting it in the anti-static bag and sending it off to SpaceX or whoever sometime in the fall. Yeah?
How large is the team?
The UVA team is 15 or so students, something like that, and there's a comparable size team at each of the other three universities. There's at least one professor at each university who's advising the group at that university. Here it's Chris Glein. He's the aerospace engineering prof here at UVA. And he teaches every semester. He teaches a fourth year capstone class on spacecraft design. So his class, his spacecraft design class, has been designing the satellite over the past several years. A couple of years ago, they launched a prototype on a high altitude balloon and tested some of the systems and with some success. So on the order of 40 people, something like that.
Do your satellites have solar cells or anything to keep the batteries up?
Yes, they do. Yep. Sorry, Joe. I'm sorry. You couldn't see that. Apologize. Five of the six faces are covered with solar cells, and then there's a battery because, of course, the satellite will spend some fraction of its time in eclipse. So there are batteries to carry it through the eclipse, and just like I did a link budget to figure out whether I have more gain than loss, the electrical team for each of the schools is doing a power budget to make sure that they've got more power generated by the solar cells than they're going to draw down with all of the electronics on the satellite. There's a weight budget. The another team that's looking at weight budgets. There are teams that are looking at heat. If you've never really thought about it, how do you cool things on Earth? You blow air over them. That doesn't work in space. So heat is actually really hard to get rid of in space. The only way to get rid of heat is to radiate it. And so these things are designed to generate as little waste heat as possible, and so you don't have to get rid of it.
Yeah. Are there any attempts to make a communication using the LoRa modules? Because that's one of the benefits of those. They have a comparatively huge link budget to normal modulation methods.
Yeah. Yeah, so like I say, the plan is to communicate between the satellites using those modules. Don't know yet. There are potential licensing issues with that. The problem is satellites are by their very nature international. At one point or another, these low Earth orbit satellites will go over every nation on Earth, and so you have to think about licensing in an international way, and you can't carry terrestrial assumptions into space. So the fact that these LoRa radios are unlicensed in the United States means nothing in space, and it's not clear that it will be legal to use them for terrestrial communications from the satellite. It just may not be permitted. Technically speaking, probably doable.
Yeah, I saw there's a guy recently who did 150 kilometers for yeah. 0.1 the surface.
Right. I think we will. We're assuming that our ground stations will be able to hear the satellites talking to each other.
Okay.
But it's really doubtful that we'll be allowed to try to talk to them. We'll be able to listen, but we probably won't be able to transmit to them.
Are those use the 900 or the 800
hertz? They're using the 70 centimeter, actually, which I thought was an interesting choice. Yeah, the lower our radios are at a frequency that's not very far removed from the uplink downlink radio. They've made a couple of choices that I probably wouldn't have made as somebody who understands radio, but we'll see how it works.
So if you can't transmit over other countries, why can't you transmit if it's directly overhead your own country? It's your airspace system.
Because it doesn't come straight down. So you're same reason when you're on HF, you have to comply with international law.
Right.
You can't just ignore regulation in the rest of the world when you're on HF because those signals propagate worldwide. And likewise, when satellites up 120 miles and over the Earth, even over a really big country, your signal is still hitting other countries. So there really is no time when the satellite is can be heard from only a single country. Yeah, you could put a really big directional antenna and get the side lobes way down. You know, I think a 10 centimeter cube with a 30 foot Yagi hanging off the bottom, that'd be an interesting satellite. Okay, thanks a lot.